Picture this. You're a food technician for a soft drink company, and you've been given the task of determining the citric acid concentration in the company's new soft drink. How exactly do you get the concentration of a substance? I mean, it's not as easy to record as a boiling point, or surface area, or volume. Well, the answer is pretty simple. We use a process known in chemistry as titration. Titration is a simple technique chemists have developed where you use a solution of known concentration to find the concentration of a solution where the concentration is unknown. To see how much citric acid is present in the drink, you simply have to measure how much base is needed to completely neutralize the solution's pH. But you can't just pour the base into the acid. You need to be more precise. And that's where...
Okay, so this part of the video was supposed to be like a segment inside of a lab, but the video is getting a bit too long, so I'm gonna just explain all of these parts really quick.
This is called what?
This is the conical flask. It holds the unknown sample. In our case, this would be the beverage.
This is called what?
This is the burette, and it holds the titrant, also known as the solution of known concentration.
And what is this?
This is the valve. When you turn it, it slowly releases titrant into the conical flask.
And perhaps what is this?
This is the titration setup. We have a burette which is holding our substance of known concentration, and a valve which, when turned, releases this titrant into the conical flask, and inside the conical flask is our beverage of unknown concentration. Now that you know about the pieces in a titration, it's really important to go over indicators. Indicators tell you when the solution of unknown concentration is perfectly neutralized. The endpoint tracks this, as the endpoint is the instance where the indicator's color stops fading. You could see in this example when the endpoint is reached. Different from the endpoint, the equivalence point is the point in the titration where neutralization has actually occurred. The endpoint is just the point where a significant pH change occurs, which permanently changes the indicator's color. Equivalence points can be represented in titration curves, which graph pH according to the amount of titrant added to the unknown solution. There are four main titrations which occur. The first is strong acid, strong base, which reaches an equivalence point at a pH of 7. Then there's strong base, weak acid, which reaches an equivalence point of a pH greater than 7, so more basic. And then there's strong acid, weak base, which reaches an equivalence point less than 7 pH, which is more acidic. And then lastly, you have weak acid, weak base, which is really used very rarely, and its equivalence point is often subject to error. So we're not going to do any problems for that one. Now that you know what it takes to do a titration and why chemists use this process, it's time to solve some problems. For part A, we're essentially doing the problem before any titration occurs. So we're gonna find the pH of the sample before any base is added. So the first step in any of these questions when you're given a volume in milliliters is to convert that into liters by dividing by 1,000. One of the key things to remember about strong acids and strong bases is that they're strong because they completely dissociate. So in the case of hydrochloric acid, you see it completely dissociates in a 1-to-1 ratio into hydronium. So because of this, if we solve for the amount of moles of hydrochloric acid, we're essentially finding the amount of moles of hydronium because it's a 1-to-1 ratio. Okay, so using what you're given, you multiply the volume of hydrochloric acid by its concentration and you get 0.0105 moles. And because of the 1-to-1 ratio between hydrochloric acid and hydronium in its dissociation, this amount, the 0.0105 moles, is our answer. That's the amount of hydronium left over. For the second part of this question, it asks for the pH of the solution. So basically what you do is you convert this molar value, the 0.0105 moles of hydronium, into a concentration, and you essentially do that by dividing the amount of moles by the total volume. So here you would do 0.0105 divided by 0.03 liters of solution, and you would get 0.35 that's the concentration value. You may have seen this formula before. pH is equal to negative log of the hydronium concentration. And by using this, you get a pH value. So negative log of 0.35 gives you 0.456, and that's our final answer. So now we get into an actual titration question. What is the amount of hydronium and the pH after 50 milliliters of NaOH is added? Okay, so to find the leftover amount of hydronium, we really just have to find the moles of hydroxide in this 50 milliliters of titrant and subtract that amount from the hydronium value we got in question one. And just like hydrochloric acid, sodium hydroxide completely dissociates in a 1-to-1 ratio. Okay, so first we basically have to find the amount of hydroxide in the solution when you titrate 15 milliliters of that strong base into it. So to find the leftover amount of hydronium after 15 milliliters of sodium hydroxide is added, we really just have to find the moles of hydroxide in this 15 milliliters of titrant and subtract that amount from the hydronium value we got in question one. We basically just do stoichiometry and we find the amount of moles of sodium hydroxide is 0.00525 moles. So now we can find leftover hydronium by creating a before add after table and subtracting the amount of hydroxide from 0.0105. So we get 0.00525 moles of hydronium left over. So to find concentration now, we just divide this amount by the total volume. To find volume, you add the 15 milliliters of base to our 30 milliliters of acid. So the total volume is 0.045 liters. And you divide the amount of H plus by this value, and you get 0.1167 moles per liter of H plus. Now, you plug this into the log equation, which finds you pH, and you get 0.933 as our pH. So that's our final answer. All right, so part C asks for the pH at the equivalence point. Because we're titrating strong acid with strong base, the hydronium and hydroxide combine to become H2O, which has a pH of 7. So for all questions regarding strong acid, strong base titrations, the equivalence point will be 7. In question 2a, you have to find the concentration of our formic acid and plug it into an ice table and then solve for x. So you plug your values in and then you come up with Ka is equal to x squared divided by 0.1 minus x. And for this case, the 100 rule applies, so you can cancel out the x and it just becomes x squared over 0.2. And now all that's left is finding the initial pH. So you solve for x by rooting the equation, isolating for x. And then you get x is equal to 0.006, which is our hydronium concentration. And you plug it into negative log of the hydronium concentration is equal to pH. And your final answer is 2.22. Okay, so because this is a weak acid, strong base question, it's really different from the first one, and there's gonna be so many more steps we have to do. So here are some of the steps. First, we're finding the concentration of the unreacted formic acid and the leftover salt. We're creating an ice table with concentration values, and we're solving for x. Then we're using that x value to find the pH of the resulting solution. Okay, so let's start with what we're given. We're given the concentration of formic acid, and we're given the volume of it. And then we're given the concentration of the strong base and the volume of it, 0.025 liters. Okay, so the first thing we do is find the moles of hydronium by multiplying the concentration of the formic acid by its volume, and you get 0.04 moles of hydronium. And then our second step is finding the moles of hydroxide by multiplying the volume of the strong base by its concentration. And then lastly, you subtract the hydroxide from the hydronium, and you get 0.03 moles of hydronium left over. As you can see, when the two substances react, hydronium is not completely canceled out by the hydroxide in the solution. So therefore, this 0.03 moles of hydroxide is actually 0.03 moles of our unreacted formic acid. So what's left from this reaction are two entities, our acidic salt and our unreacted formic acid. To create an ice table and solve for our pH, we have to turn these two values of leftover solution into concentrations. So you have to divide them by the total volume after the titration. Now that we've found two concentrations, one for an acidic salt and one for the unreacted formic acid, we can plug these values into an ice table. Now, if you don't know how to make an ice table, I recommend you catch up on that before finishing the rest of this video. So you plug your values into the ice table and you solve for X. From these values, you're left with the equation X times 2 over 45 plus X divided by 2 over 15 minus X is equal to our Ka value. You can find the Ka value by looking on the Ka table. Now, this looks complicated and difficult to solve, but the 100 rule applies for both of the brackets. So how do you know if the 100 rule applies? You simply just divide the concentration by the Ka, and if it's over 100, then the 100 rule applies and you can cancel out the X's. So with the X's canceled out, the equation is far easier to solve and you get 5.4 times 10 to the negative 4. Because this X value is our hydronium concentration, you can just plug it into the negative log equation and you'll get our pH. So we're left with a pH of 3.3 after 25 milliliters of potassium hydroxide is added. Question 2C is going to be quite a bit different from 2B and 2A. 2A was before any titrant was added. 2B was before the equivalence point. And now 2C is going to be at the equivalence point. So there's going to be a lot of different processes in this one. Okay, so let's start by doing what we did in question 2B. Let's find the moles of hydroxide and hydronium and then subtract them from one another. And what you'll notice is that these two values cancel each other out completely. So this means we're at the equivalence point, but because it's weak acid, strong base, we don't stop here. You see, whereas with a strong acid and strong base, the two completely neutralize into H2O, here you have a leftover salt once again. Okay, so this salt comes from the weak acid, and although it's weak, it's basic enough to hydrolyze. And so we can show the reaction of this basic salt in water on our ice table. So like the last question, our 100 rule applies and we should be able to simplify this equation. It's also worth noting that because we're solving for the hydroxide value and not the hydronium, we're using KB instead of KA. If you want to find KB, you can find it by dividing KW over KA and you'll get the right value. So what we're left with after canceling out these values and making the equation equal to the KB value is 5.55 times 10 to the negative 11 is equal to X squared divided by 2 over 15. And from that, we can find that X is equal to 2.72 times 10 to the negative 6. So since that's our hydronium value, we plug it into the pOH equation. And then to turn pOH into pH, you simply subtract the pOH value from 14. And our final answer is 8.43. Our next question, question C, represents a situation where we're past the equivalence point and we've titrated too much strong base. So you should expect our answer, based on the fact that we've titrated too much strong base, to be over 7, significantly over 7. So we start this problem as we do any other one. We find the moles of hydronium and the moles of hydroxide and we subtract them from one another. And what we notice here is that we actually have more hydroxide than we do hydronium for the first time. And what this essentially means is that the concentration of our acid is all the hydronium, all the acidic part of it is completely canceled out by our base because we've just overtaken it with strong base. So essentially what's left is our concentration of hydroxide, which is 0.1 moles. So we've got the concentration of hydroxide. We can just plug that straight into the pOH equation and solve for pH. So after you finish all the calculations, you find that pOH is 1, and our pH, as expected, is significantly greater than 7 because, once again, it's covered in strong base. It's like if you did a titration and you just left the knob on and you just let it turn pink until it was just as vibrant as possible.
3, 2, 1, go.
And that's it. Hopefully you learned something new about titrations. If you want to see more videos like this, make sure to check out my channel. Hit the bell, follow, subscribe. I'm on Twitter, I'm on Instagram, I'm on Patreon, I'm on TikTok, I'm on Rumble. I'm also on TikTok.